the Pledge of Allegiance, so if everybody could stand if you are able. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. If you could remain standing for a moment. Let's have a moment of silence in light of all of the recent violence that we've been seeing on television. We have a moment of silence for all of the recent victims of unnecessary violence against citizens of the United States and also for the police. Thank you very much. Please be seated. I don't know if you're excited about Miller's Barbecue back again by popular demand, so we're excited we'll be eating it very shortly here. I don't know how we did it for the second year in a row. We got probably the best band in the state of Georgia to play music for you. I don't know how we did it. The Backstreet Blazers. We got Blake on drums, Dave on bass guitar. Where's Bridget? Bridget's amazing on lead vocals. So thank you for playing music. How about the people who helped with the setup today? Could you stand up? Be recognized, Gretchen, Dennis. I see we need a stronger tape over here, but that's okay. Thank you. Lowndes County Democratic Party officers. To make all these things happen, we need officers. So if the officers could not stand up and be acknowledged, Dennis, Gretchen, where's Glenn, Richie, over here, where's Jim Parker? So thank you for everything you do to make this happen. Also want to thank Mayor Ted Terry. Are you here? Thank you, Ted Terry. We're excited to hear from you. Thanks for coming down to talk with us. And also Jim Barksdale. Thank you, sir, for coming to speak with us. Want to make an announcement that if there is a runoff election for coroner right now, if you're not aware, John Hogan, I believe, is here. There he is. He's going to be talking with us. And Brad Carter, somewhere over here. Brad is here as well. Early voting is going on now, 8 to 5 p.m. this week during the weekdays, and next week during the week from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. I think last week there was only 200 people voting. So we really need you to go out and vote for one of these outstanding candidates. The day of the election is 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. That's July 26th. Really quickly before we hear from Mayor Tetteri, we all know Georgia, I don't know if you've seen the polls, but Georgia is now a toss-up state. Have you heard this? The CNN poll says we're purple now. That's a good thing. Let's hear it. So part of it is changing demographics, but part of that is also the grassroots stuff that we do here at the local level. The local parties here, like in Lowndes County. I know Mark Anderson, where are you at? I just had a chance to visit Mark somewhere around here. He's the chairman of the Thomas County Democratic Party. They're doing fantastic things. I went out to visit them last week. They got a thriving party. They're doing a lot of outreach. So collectively, we're going to keep doing outreach. We're going to continue to grow the party, educate people about what we stand for as Democrats. The next president, as we know, this election is important because the next president will be making life-death decisions. And will also be setting the cultural tone for this country. So, the next president will also be selecting up to four Supreme Court nominees. Up to four. So we know how important this presidential race is. And fortunately, as Democrats, we've had two amazing candidates, Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton. Bernie Sanders, as many of you know, he's been arrested fighting for civil rights. He has a long record fighting against economic inequality. He's also tried to hold Wall Street accountable. Hillary Clinton has also led civil rights demonstrations while she was in college. She made a lot of enemies when she pushed for universal health care. A lot of you remember as First Lady, she led a task force. Fighting for universal health care, and made a lot of Republican enemies and corporate enemies because of that. And she's also introduced legislation to fight against voter suppression. So both of these candidates have a long history of fighting for social justice issues. So I'm proud that both of them have been our candidates. But also, it's important to get involved at the state and local levels. We have an amazing candidate, Jim Barksdale. He's running for Georgia's U.S. Senate seat. I had a chance to meet him today. He's an amazing person. He's a successful businessman. And he also agrees with a lot of the things that Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton have to say. And you'll be hearing from him in a little bit. But also at the local levels. You're going to hear from some candidates that are running at the local level. Please support them. They need your help. They need all of our help. And maybe that's financial. Maybe it's knocking on a few doors. Maybe it's talking with your neighbors. But it's important for all of us to get the word out to help support our fellow Democrats here in Knox County. Without further ado, I would like to invite Mayor Ted Terrio to the stage. He's from Clarkston, Georgia, and he's been in the news. Clarkston has been in the news lately because they just passed a $15 minimum wage ordinance. Okay. We're going to eat first and then get Ted Terrio to come up? Okay. All right. Democracy in action. But you'll be hearing from Ted Terrio, $15 an hour in Clarkston. And they also recently decriminalized marijuana. So if you get caught with marijuana under 1 ounce, you don't get thrown in jail, you get a $75 fine. It's been all over the news. Hopefully it sets a precedent here in Georgia. So he's going to talk a little bit about his accomplishments. But we're going to get some food, and then we're going to hear from Mayor Ted Terrio. So we want to go ahead and start over at these tables here. Go ahead and make a line. And the guys are going to play some dinner music, right?
Okay, I'm buzzing for a second. I have $13.50 and I have $175 in my hand. So if you want to buy another chicken, you'll give me half of the money in my hand for a dollar chance. The other is Ted Terry and I are both delegates to the Democratic National Convention, which is at the end of the month. Ted and I have to pay our own way. So we're going to pass the half. We're going to split the money that you generously donate to help us go. So I hope you can represent you. Some other announcements. There's the quiz on the table. So, the quiz doesn't have the prize as far as I know, but the table that fills out the quiz, it has the best, the smartest ones that just get to brag. And the other thing is, I have a survey which I'll pass out. Rate 1 to 5 your top issues because the Democratic platform is not set yet. When we get to Philadelphia, we can lobby the platform committee with our top issues. So I'm going to pass those around 1 to 5 top issues to the platform.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bridget Hyman, please vote.
Say about Miller's barbecue. It's pretty good. All right. Fantastic. I'm going to invite our first speaker. Again, Ted Terry is the mayor of Clarkston, Georgia. They're doing some fantastic things there. So without further ado, can we get Mayor Ted Terry to line up? It's like a Tonight Show.
You have to hit the drums when I tell jokes. Good evening, Democrats. So I don't want to be too long-winded. I drove down from Clarkston this afternoon.
And is it far?
What's that?
Is it far?
It's like a four-hour drive. Yeah, Georgia's a big state. But it was good. I haven't been to my house for about 10 minutes. My arms are tired. That's what I got. I just flew in. My arms are tired. Yeah. And I haven't been to Austin in a while, so it's good to be back with y'all. For those who don't know, Clarkston, Georgia is in Metro Atlanta. It's right 20 minutes east of downtown between Stone Mountain and Decatur. If you've ever been on the 285 loop, it's just right there to the east, right off the exits. We're a town of 1.4 square miles. All right, so just think, we're basically a circle, a little fuel annexation spurs. And we have 13,000 people in our city. All right, one person earlier was like, that's a lot of people. Gosh, how do you get them all in there? Clarkston used to be what was called a jackwater town. And so that was back in the late 1900s, early 20th century, when they had a steam locomotive, come through town. And Clarkston literally was a farming town. It was more goats than people. The railroad was right through the middle of the town, and there was a water tower and a train depot, and the train would literally stop, fill up the steam engine tank with water, drop off the mail, and then head on into Atlanta, and never come back, a couple hours later, back out to Augusta, going down the Augusta line. But of course, over the years, Atlanta grew, so Clarkston founded in 1882, was just sort of like this excerpt, right? It was like out on the outskirts of Atlanta. Now the outskirts of Atlanta are like Henry County, Forsyth, and Douglas. They're just getting wider and broader. And Clarkston is literally like right outside the bubble. And over the years, as Atlanta grew, more apartment complexes were built, and neighborhoods, and now DeKalb County, which is the county we're in, is like this one giant neighborhood. But we have a lot of apartment complexes, and that's how you get that many people in 1.4 square miles. Now, Clarkston is also known as the most ethnically diverse square mile in America. Not the most ethnically diverse square mile, but I would say in terms of the ethnically diverse square mile cities go, we're definitely up there, all right? And we have people from 40 different nationalities who speak 60 different languages in our city. All right, now how is that possible? Anybody know why that might have happened? So, a lot of immigration, but very specific immigration. So everyone's been familiar with what's been happening in Syria lately. Okay, so the past almost four years in the civil war in Syria, brought on by famine and drought in the rural areas, forcing people to move to the cities, which inflamed ethnic tensions, resources were strapped, and the government basically cracked down on, at first, peaceful protests, but have now since turned into a civil war. And so we literally have almost 6 million Syrians who have fled their homes, either in Syria to another part of Syria, who are in refugee camps in Jordan and in Turkey, to the tune of about 2 million people. And then the other about 1.5 to 2 million people have literally been walking across Turkey, taking what they call the death boats across the Mediterranean, and then continuing to walk across Europe, all right, like to France, and then to England, to Sweden, to all over the European Union, seeking refuge. Now in America, we have what's called the 1980 Refugee Act. It was implemented by Jimmy Carter. And then Ronald Reagan signed it. Every president has signed the Refugee Act in 1980 every year, including this year. And that act basically says we will, as part of the United Nations Treaty on Refugees, we will be a part of 19 countries in the world that will actually try to help relieve the suffering and the situation of people who are basically in limbo. They call refugee resettlement a third country solution because they've left their first country, they're in a second country in limbo, and they're trying to get to a third country, which hopefully will give them some stability and be able to think about the future. And so Clarkston, over the past 35 years, has been one of the main resettlement sites for the Department of State in Georgia. So almost every state gets refugees resettled. It's a very rigorous process. There's lots of vetting. There's almost 2.5 years of actual like interviews and background checks and war waiting. And first the United Nations does a check on you. Then Homeland Security does a check on you. And then if you're from Syria, you go through the Syria Enhanced Review, which is another 6 months. And because this humanitarian crisis is so large, 5 to 6 million people, but security parameters for refugee resettlement to America are so stringent, we are only seeing a trickle of refugees from these areas of the world. And the trickle will continue. It's always just been a trickle. Clarkston is set to receive about 3,000 refugees. This is out of 100,000 nationwide. Right? About 30,000 of those are going to be Syrian refugees. So again, think about 5 million people. All right, 2 million are in camps. And those 2 million have basically applied for refugee status. So we've got 2 million people. As of this date, or actually a couple of months ago, the United Nations has taken that number down to 22,000 have actually been approved. Right? So they've gone through the first process for the United Nations. And then Homeland Security does their thing, and they will that number down to 8,000. And then as of a couple of months ago, only 2,000 Syrians have actually been resettled in the United States. So I tell you all that to say that there are people out there right now, it's kind of been backed up in the news recently because of, oh, if we let refugees into our country, if we let Muslims into our country, we're letting ISIS into our country. And so when the President Barack Obama says that the vetting, the background, the enhanced review for Syrian refugees is really stringent, that's what I'm talking about. It is spreading an evil, all right? I'm sort of starting off with this issue because it is kind of controversial. And one of the things that I think we all have to be aware of in this time of the year, and it's really this time of every 2 years, it seems, 4 years, is it's the political season, right? We are, you know, political people, we're at a Democratic barbecue, right? So we obviously care enough to listen to someone talk about political issues. Whereas, you know, we kind of, I think, live in communities that say, well, it's just not polite to talk about politics. You know, residents, we're talking about politics and religion, hear that a lot, right? Or maybe you don't, maybe you agree with that, you're like, I got a cousin who loves Donald Trump, but we don't talk about politics. Or, you know, I've got friends at my work, or I chat up with the cashier at the grocery store, or a lawn guy or a lawn woman. I've got people in my life who I interact with every day, right? So you, sir. So you have a child? Is your child right? Okay. It's your baby right here. So you probably answer. How tall is she? 3. So she's like in preschool or not yet? In a daycare, basically. She's a balloon, all right. So you know, no matter like who we are, like families. Whether we're in business, we interact with people in our daily lives that probably aren't necessarily political, right? And think about it. Raise your hand if you, like, on a daily basis, talk politics with someone. Not on Facebook, in real life, like out here in the real world, like you're like, hey, how's it going? Are you registered to vote? You are? Excellent. All right. Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump? Don't know yet. Please don't vote for Donald Trump. Well, how long have you lived here? What's your name, by the
way? I'm from Savannah area.
Okay. All right, so you're college students.
Fine.
All right. Are you in-state tuition? Okay, good. Now, I went to college, like, I went to 2005. Now, when I went to college, tuition was a lot lower, and I graduated without any college debt. I'm curious, you know, how does your situation look right now? You have to borrow money to go to school here? More or less. And do you like living in Georgia? Living in Valdosta? Anything you see like that, you know, afterwards, one thing, you just change that one thing, what would be the other thing? Well, if there's only one thing you want to change at that point, there definitely is something that one thing that needs to be talked about. Yeah, I agree. Is anyone aware of the student debt crisis that we have in this country? I've heard this before, this debt crisis. And how many here are in college right now? Raise your hand. All right, like, so a handful. Okay, so it's more than likely most of y'all, like me, went to college or came of age at a time where college actually was pretty affordable because it was almost like this sort of like, you know, like contracts, you know, the GIs went back from World War II for free college, right? And the states have been contributing lots of money to scholarships. But lately it hasn't been the case, right? Is that true? Funded by lottery, yeah. And did you heard about Hillary Clinton's new college affordability plan? Okay. Well, I'll give you the short of it. Hillary Clinton believes that two-year colleges, tech schools should be tuition free. And if you're a four-year college undergraduate, then you should graduate debt free. Does anyone agree with that?
Yes.
Yes. All right. Donald Trump, on the other hand, he doesn't have a college affordability plan. He has the mindset of, well, you know, you can afford college, you afford college, you can't. It's not a problem. So he actually has no plan. It's not indicated that this is a concern of his at all. In fact, actually, have you heard about Trump University?
Yeah, I've heard about it.
So he's been investigated, he's been sued because of making all these outlandish claims about you're going to get jobs, you're going to this and that, you've got to pay for all this money. And then he doesn't materialize. Is that right? Yeah. So based on that, do you think that you probably lean more towards Hillary as opposed to Donald Trump? Okay, you still have to decide. All right, so the point of all this, and I'll wrap up here. The point of this is we are going to have to actually convince people, persuade people that our issues and our candidates are who they should be voting for. And there's a lot of people out there, there's a lot of millennial voters who are undecided. And whether it's because of Bernie and not sure about Hillary yet, or honestly, they're just not as politically engaged, right, until it affects them. And so there's issues out here that we should feel as Democrats should be confident to actually talk about because we have a majority of people with us who support college affordability, who support, we're talking over here, about decriminalization of marijuana. All right, this is an issue that is shared by millennials, by people of all ages, and it's a bipartisan issue. A lot of Republicans, libertarians think that the war on drugs has failed. And good news from the Democratic Platform Committee, Gretchen went down there. They made a stipulation in the Democratic platform that marijuana should be taken off the Schedule 1 list of narcotics. All right, so that's a big step in the right direction towards decriminalization. And we should actually start studying a pathway to medical marijuana or legalization in the state. That is huge. That's not in the Republican platform. Right? So these are things we should feel, like, we should feel confident talking about our issues because we know the majority of Americans are with us. And so, in conclusion, and I'll have you stay around afterwards, Dennis, if anyone wants to ask any specific questions, we have to kind of go to boot camp, I would say, over these next 4 months. We're going to have to commit to be political every single day, even if it's just like I'm in the grocery store and I'm checking out and like, you are the political people in our community, and so we have to just be political. People are going to excuse us for talking politics, right? It's the freaking election. It comes around every 4 years, you know? Like, let's talk about politics. Right? This is our once-in-a-4-year shot to make a difference. And so I want to encourage everyone out there to be political over the next 4 months. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor and Secretary, appreciate that. Just so everybody knows, there's a balloon thief running around. Be very careful with that. Next, without further ado, we'd like to ask Jim Barksdale to come on. Please give him a round of applause. This is Jim Barksdale music. He wrote this one.
Thanks. I'm going to go up here just because it's so much easier to see everybody. I think it's easier for you to see me as well. So I want to just tell you a little bit about me and why I am running for the Senate. This is a very important year, I know, and none of you would be here if you didn't agree with me. So let's get right to it. I'm a sixth-generation Georgian. I grew up in Atlanta. I started out cutting grass for my neighbors when I was about 8. Had a paper route when I was 11. Before I could drive a car, I was working at the gas stations, pumping gas and changing oil. Worked all through high school. And when I went off to college, my freshman year, my father got pinched some Wall Street schemes and lost most of the money that had been saved, put away for my education. And if I hadn't had all those savings, you know, I would have been able to make it through college, but through my savings and through student loans, I did get through college and got through graduate school. Came out after that and started a business in Atlanta about 30 years ago out of my house. So I've spent 30 years in business and I know what that's like. But we became, as an investment business, and we became successful not by going along with all the crazy deals that Wall Street would put forward to people, but really by standing against those deals. Really focusing on protecting clients from losing money. Because I didn't want them to lose the way my father had lost, and I know what that feels like. And so that's where our slogan, or about standing against the crowd, comes from, because somebody needs to stand against the crowd in Washington because they aren't protecting the people, right? They've been protecting profits, the selfish profits of the people who are around the table to write the bills instead of standing up to protect the people. And that means that our system has become corrupt. There's all kinds of examples. I could go all night about all the examples and the way big money gets involved in writing the bills so that they profit, but I'm just going to mention two very quickly because I think you'll understand what I'm talking about. Certainly in the investment business, I was very aware that when they were tearing down the walls of that had protected the financial system 1999 and 2000, which my opponent participated in, that this was going to make everybody's savings in the financial system at risk. And it was that process of deregulating the financial markets in 1999 and 2000 that basically took the economy right off the cliff in 2008, and we still haven't recovered. People have been upside down in their mortgages, incomes are down, debt is up. And this was at a direct line. The Citigroup and Wall Street wanted to get rid of the deregulations and figured they would be unbridled in their ability to make money, and then that took the economy right off the cliff. We've also seen it in the bad trade deals, right? There's just the big corporations benefit because they can pay workers less, and they can avoid all of our environmental restrictions that all the things that we hold up for a decent society, right? Decent wages and a decent environment, they can bypass those things by having unregulated free trade. And I'm not arguing that trade isn't good, but you have to have some balance in the system so that our workers aren't competing against people who make, you know, 50 cents a day, who don't have an education system, who don't have any environmental restrictions, and so forth and so on. So that is what has, I think, driven a wedge into the middle class of the country, all the offshoring of our jobs. So we need to take the steps to bring jobs back. We need to take the steps to improve our infrastructure. We need to get wages up, and we need to invest in people through better education. So that's why I'm in this campaign. It's really on my part an act of faith that this is something that can happen this year if you're all fed enough to change it. I know that's why I'm in the race, is because I, sitting in Atlanta, have seen how many people have been harmed by these policies out of Washington. And I don't see anybody standing up for the people. I just see them standing up for profits. So if you all believe it's going to be a year of turnout, if we can turn out the base, this can turn this year, and we can have a Democratic senator, the first Democratic senator in Georgia in a long time. And I can promise you that I have talked to virtually all the Democratic representatives in the House, and they are just chomping at the bit to have somebody in the Senate to help out. Okay? So we need to do this for John Lewis. We need to do it for Hank Johnson. We need to do it for a lot of other Democratic representatives up there. We need a Democrat in the Senate. So I'm asking for your help. We need your money. We need your time. We need your effort. We need your friends. We need everybody. Our website is jimbarksdaleforsenate.com. Give us whatever support you can. Thank you, Tom and Gretchen, so much for your help. And I'm sorry we have to leave. We've got to get up to Savannah tonight, but really enjoyed being here tonight with you.
Thank you, Jim Barksdale. I understand you can buy one of those hats. I understand you can buy one of those hats online for $100. Is that right?
That's right.
I'm getting one. Now, we have the 50-50. Yeah, what's it up to, Gretchen?
You're going to get $103.
Who's going to win $103 right now?
Ticket is
861. 861. Got a winner. Thank you. So that means $103 goes to the Lowndes Democratic Party, and we will use that money to help get Democrats elected. So thank everybody for participating. I know we have a winner here for the trivia contest. Vic Sager was running. Do we have all the? Not yet. Okay, we'll come back to that. Let's get our next speaker up here. U.S. Representative, 8th Congressional District, James Neal Harris. Please come on up to the stage. Please put your hands together.
How's everybody doing? I appreciate everybody coming down.
Put the mic closer to your mouth.
I have a loud voice, but I don't blow it. But between Lowndes County and Gill County, I've had poor health in the 8th District, these two counties, and I have anywhere else in Georgia's 8th District. And I was born in Bibb County, above the center of Central Georgia, raised in Jones County, went to Jones County schools. Was a Bibb County deputy sheriff, retired from Bibb County. Now I'm in private practice. 40 plus years my father, and 10 years old, started graduating in political events. And I worked on city, county, state, federal election there since I was 10 years old, putting up signs, knocking on doors, doing something. But my mother passed away about 5 weeks ago. My father passed away in 99. Christ followed Christian people from Baptist. And the main reason that I'm running is because I'm sick and tired. Working all these candidates, regardless of who they are, regardless of where they're from. And then they get up there, and all of a sudden they're like, James Newman, heard that guy's name. Well, what does he want? And so, me, myself, I'm a Christ following Baptist Christian. With me, it's God first, God foremost, and God forever. And I pray about everything out there. My wife asked me before I decided to run, she said, are you sure this is what you want to do? And I said, well, for lack of anybody else willing to stand up here and take a chance. Because in law enforcement, you learn to take pot shots from just about everybody. And of course, course, and that's the nature of the job, and you're not able to take my job from everybody, and that's not the job somebody like that should have. But a lot of my focus is on taxes. I think they're unfairly applied. I think they're unfairly distributed amongst all of us. And I think something needs to be done about that. As far as jobs, I understand what they're saying about this minimum wage. It does need to be raised, but at the same time, every time Congress proposes labor increase, before it's even approved, the prices out here on the street, people buying groceries go up, and so by the time you get your minimum wage increase, you don't have a minimum wage increase. You're no better off today than you were yesterday. I try not to watch people too intently, but I was in the grocery store here several days ago, and I see this elderly woman, and she's holding one can in one hand and the other can in the other hand, trying to decide which one she can afford to buy and which one she can't afford to buy. And those people up there in Washington, D.C., and I don't care who they are, all of them ought to be ashamed. I'll tell you something, between children, I'm strong on taking care of children because children are not capable of taking care of themselves. And I'm strong on taking care of the elderly people. My father got sick back in 97. I looked after him when nobody else would. My mother got sick, looked after her. She passed away. I like this right here. You've done everything you can for a person. I don't know what else you can do, but everything you can possibly do. But education, my biggest problem, Georgia ranks near the bottom of the list, and my immediate policy, if we're near the bottom of the list, who is number one on the list, and what are they doing that we're not doing? I believe we should have some form of prayer back in school. If whether it's nothing but a moment of silence, it should be something. Take God out of the picture, then what else do you have? My official position, the student debt crisis, I have a friend of mine, she went to nursing school for 6 years, and I don't know the exact breakdown of it, but she gets to the final year, fails the final test. Now this woman has gone out and borrowed 6 years for education. She does not wind up with a degree. Winds up cleaning the toilets in the hospital instead of a nursing room. And I have a tremendous problem with somebody going out on the limb to borrow that kind of money to put yourself through school and go 6 years, and then they find out there's a problem with this person by something done in the first year, the second year, the third year, before she incurred all this debt. Because just because she didn't get that nursing job, guess what? She still owes that 6 years of money she borrowed to go to nursing school. My position is pro-life. That's my political position. My personal position is it should be between the baby's mother, her mother, the pastor of that church, and God. That's where I start, that's where I stand, and that's where I stay. The only reason that I do pro-life is because you've got pro-life or the other one, and I prefer pro-life because I think the sanctity of life maintained at all counts as long as feasibly, financially, physically possible. Gun ownership? Yeah, I'm all for gun ownership. I've got so many guns that I own. I don't know how many guns I own. I'm not bragging. I'm just simply making a statement. I grew up around them. I was taken out. I was taught what a gun can do when it's used the right way. And I was taken out and taught what a gun can do when it's used the wrong way. One thing that I have on something like that is education, education, education. If you're afraid of something, chances are you'll wind up in the possession of it. You're not going to know what to do. As far as these shootings, I don't want to knock because I was not there. You weren't there. We don't know what happens. We only see what the news media chooses to show us. But one thing I will tell you, I'm not being disrespectful toward any police officer. My father was a police officer for 27 years. He retired from the city. All my family were police department, fire department. I was on one family. down to the sheriff. But the thing about a sheriff is do the elected person by all these people that are capable of voting. And this county, you know, can't be accountable by all of these people at some point in that process. A police chief is only accountable for those four or five city council people that's on that, over that city. And I've gone to the training center, I've been in classes a lot of years. They take you to recite, they teach you how to be a deputy sheriff, how to be a department correctional person, or a state trooper, or a police officer. And the minute you get back to your department, they say, look, we don't care what they taught you up there, that's not how we do things here. We get everything they taught you, this is the way we're going to work. And a lot of these officers put out here on the street, they're not giving any training. One thing I like about Big County, they put you in the jail 2 or 3 years where you're dealing with the people that you're going to be dealing with on the street. And so when you get that patrol car, you know how to respect that person, whether they're a taxpayer citizen or not. And so that's a bad, bad thing about these shootings. But unfortunately, the other thing that I'm sure all of y'all are aware of, they're not proactive, law enforcement's not. They're reactive. They don't do something until something happens. And it's a case in point. 2 Saturdays ago, it was under retired deputy. I worked under a licensed private investigator across the state of Georgia. I was going up the road. There was this car stolen that we didn't know at the time. Runs through a red traffic light, T-bones the car, knocks it 3 car lengths sideways. Rolls back and takes off because it's stolen. And unbeknownst to us, it was stolen. Took off down the side street, slammed on brakes, pulled out the car, and they'll take off. Clinical, I have one of my 12-gauge shotguns in the car, and I'm going to call 911 to come find out the person in that car had 6 warrants on it. But anyway, I appreciate all of y'all coming out. I hope to see a lot more of you between now and then. I hope you'll get out and support these candidates because they need all the help. Anybody that's strong enough to stand up here in a position like this right here is divided as this country is in so many areas right now. Willing to take a chance and try to make things better. I applaud for myself. I hope all of y'all did. Hopefully we'll get out and support these candidates. Hopefully come November the 8th. The gentleman that's in the 8th district right now will no longer be in the 8th district.